ओम सदाशिव समारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरु परंपरां। ओम पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ओम शांति शांति शांति। ओम नमो ब्रह्मादिभ्यो ब्रह्म विद्या संप्रदाय कर्तृभ्यो वंश ऋषिभ्यो नमो गुरुभ्यः। वी वर लुकिंग एट द इंट्रोडक्शन टू द सेकंड अध्याय द फर्स्ट ब्राह्मण। सो हियर व्हाइल इंट्रोड्यूसिंग भाष्यकार हैड पॉइंटेड आउट दैट Both Vidya Vishaya and Avidya Vishaya has been discussed already in the first chapter. Then the Avidya Sutra was presented, and later on, the Avidya Vishaya was discussed in detail to show that all the means and ends which we have in terms of Putra, Vitta, and also achieving, and even wife, all these things are means, correct, to do karma, upasana. And then karma and upasana themselves become means to achieve ends, like this loka or pitriloka or devaloka. Finally, you can do prana upasana and be one with prana, means you can either attain the loka of prana or attain sayujya. Also it was talked about, you become one with prana, pranatma you became. That means you are like prajapati, you attain the status of prajapati. Now this was mentioned, then finally it was said that everything is nothing but nama, rupa and karma. Okay, nama rupam karma, like that it was presented. This entire objective world can be looked at as nama, rupam and karma. Now this particular chapter, then why are we starting? So that is what now Bhashyakara is trying to give the connection. So now in the second chapter, in fact, the apavada of all the vishayas, avidya vishaya particularly, which we are talked about before, will be done. That is the main tatparya here in the second chapter, because whatever was talked about in terms of sadhana and sadhya, or in terms of the jiva being karta bhokta, all these things are nothing but adhyaropa only. Now these things have to be negated. So that's why we are starting this. But while doing this, now we looked at all this, how Bhashyakara has introduced, some other Upanishads and all he had quoted. So we looked at all those things already. Here there is one spelling mistake is there. Typo, it says prana yeko veda iti uchyate in this site at least, but it should be prana yeko deva iti uchyate, ekaha devaha. And in fact there are a couple of references to this. One is there in Brihadaranyaka itself, later on we'll see, very interesting. The third chapter in Brihadaranyaka, different people are questioning Yajnavalkya. So in the third chapter, ninth brahmana, there is an interesting conversation where Yajnavalkya is asked how many devas are there. Then initially he says 3003 are there, then he says 303, then 33. That questioner keeps on asking again and again, even after he gives a number, how many devas are there. Then he says 6, 3, 2, 1.5, and then 1. Like that there is one answer he gives. So finally that ekaha devaha is prana, like that it is said there also. That means this one prana devata alone is manifest as all these countless devatas. Okay, so that is our understanding. So that is presented there very nicely in that Brahmana. But we will come to that. I don't know when. It will take another year, I think, in this rate. So this prana is one deva only, who is manifest as all the other devatas also. Now that fits here also. See, immediately what Bhashyakara says is, tasyaiva bahyaha pindaha ekaha sadharanaha suryadi pravibhakta karanaha. Like that he gives. Okay. So this prana, even though is one devata, but the prana's body, if you take the pinda here, is you have to take it as body, the external body or whatever is like body for this prana devata. It is common. There is only one body for this prana devata. That is the totality we are talking about. In that suryadi pravibhakta karanaha, like that it says. That means, see, the body is looked upon as karya, and the indriyas are all looked upon as karana, correct? Indriya and manas. So if you take the prana as a devata, the prana's body is the totality of all the physical world itself you can take. And even in that, again, other devatas like Surya are all like the indriya for this prana devata. Okay, so they are all, again, separately, or you can divide this prana devata into different parts, and each part will be one devata, something like that. And they all correspond to, like we have different indriyas, prana devata also is having all these other devatas as a part and also as functioning like indriyas for us. And here again, Bhashyakara in between, he says, all these different names are also given for that one pinda only, like Virat. Virat as a term, we understand that Virat means the totality of the physical cosmos. You can take it as Virat, we say. Then Vaishvanaraha, also another word. Or Purusha Vidaha was given in the fourth Brahmana. In the previous chapter, the fourth Brahmana is actually called Purusha Vidha Brahmana, because it starts like that. The Prajapati was there in the form of a Purusha. So Purusha Vidaha means, or Atma Purusha Vidaha, means here the Atma in the form of a human being. Then Prajapati, the word Kaha also is another word. Hiranyagarbha. Hiranyagarbha means, generally we understand it as the totality of the subtle bodies or the subtle world. So all these terms are all referring to the same prana. Okay. So Atmatvena Upagataha. Sorry, ityadibihi pinda pradanehi shabdehi akhyayate, like that Bhashyakara adds here. So all these words are all only with reference to the pinda of the prana, means the, with reference to different bodies of this prana you can take. Because prana is only manifest as all these things. Depending on which standpoint you look at this prana, you can use different words. And this prana alone is divided into all these devatas, different devatas like Surya, etc. So, ekamcha anekamcha brahma yetavadeva na ataha paramasti pratyekamcha sharira bedeshu parisamaptam chetanavat kartru bhoktru cha iti avidya visheyameva atmatvena upagataha gargyaha brahmanaha vakta upasthapyate. Okay, now Bhashyakara comes to the actual this particular brahmana. So now this prana as a devata, who is now again manifest as all these different devatas in different bodies, correct? This is also avidya vishaya only. Okay, now this Brahman, which is jagat karanam, is one. But again, it is really manifest as different things, correct? This is more like Vishishtadvaita, you can say. Ekam cha anekam cha brahma yetavadeva. This Brahman, you can look at Brahman as one, but again, this one Brahman is having many parts, correct? And that's all is Brahman. Okay, Brahman alone is there, but Brahman itself is divided into many. This way you look at it, and then there is nothing more than that. There is nothing transcending all these different objects, different parts. So, na atav paramasti. Okay, there is nothing transcending this or greater than this. And further, what? Pratyekancha sharira bedeshu parisamaptam chetanavat kartribhoktrucha. Again, what? This Brahman only is manifest in each and every body. Okay. Every pratyekancha sharira bedeshu. So there are different bodies are there. Differences in terms of how many sentient beings are there. And that sentiency itself ends with the body only. Okay. That is the experience also, correct? Normally, our sentiency, the awareness or consciousness is only limited to the body. So everybody takes oneself as this embodied consciousness. Even if they have an understanding that I am a conscious being, their understanding is such that my consciousness ends within this body alone, correct? That is the individual awareness or my own understanding of myself as an individual. There is an individual identity which is born of an understanding like this. Although this understanding itself is what we call avichara siddha, because it has not been arrived at after any study of the shastra or deep analysis or anything. It is how everybody takes oneself, or maybe the society, and once you are born, you are conditioned to think that way, and many people die also without ever questioning that. Okay, they take themselves for granted, and that's how their life goes. So this, like this, all these things are real. Okay, so different bodies are there, consciousness is there in all these bodies, and that consciousness itself is restricted only to those bodies, and that conscious being itself is the karta bhokta, is the doer and enjoyer. Like this, there is a view. So even though in this view there is one deva and one Brahman, okay, one Ishvara, Jagat Karanam and all that, but that Jagat Karanam is looked upon as having all these many different parts, and each part has its own reality. Okay, you can take it like this. But all these things are what? Iti avidya vishayameva. These are all still only avidya vishaya. Atmatvena upagataha. Again, this way, the one who looks at oneself, okay, who is that person? Gargyaha. Gargyaha means garga gotrodbhavaha. Again, this is tadita pratyaya. And so garga gotra, the one who is born in the garga gotra, gargyaha. And he is balakihi. Okay, but that balaki name will come later, I think. So gargyaha brahmanaha vakta upasthapyate. So in this brahmana, the Upanishad is going to talk about a brahmana as the vakta, means he is the one who is going to go and talk or lecture the king. Okay, a brahmana, normally in those days it is very common, correct? Whenever a brahmana wants some money or some resources, whatever, they will go to the king and show their knowledge, okay, what all they know. And then the king also, if he is pleased with whatever is on display, then king will reward accordingly. So this has been the way the brahmanas had some support from the state, you can say. So this brahmana now is the one who is going and talking to the king, but he is having a view like this. That means he is a avidyavan. Okay, he is an ajnani. But he goes, and with that some pride of being a brahmana, he talks as though he knows everything. Okay, he is now trying to actually lecture the king. That is the scenario. That's how this brahmana starts, interestingly. But the more interesting thing is what? Tad viparita atmadrike ajata shatruhu shrota. But ajata shatru is the king here. He is a kshatriya, but he has a different view of Brahman. He understands Brahman, in fact, as it should be understood. But he is the listener. So this brahmana goes and gives lecture to ajata shatru, and he is the listener. So evam hi yataha purvapaksha siddhanta akhyayika rupena samarpyamanaha arthaha Shrotuhu Chittasya Vashameti. Okay, so Bhashyakara says, now, okay, this is how it is presented in this Brahmana. Now, Bhashyakara is giving justification for that. He says, in this manner only, by presenting a story with the Purvapaksha and Siddhanta. Okay, here actually the Purvapaksha is what is being said by the Vakta, and Siddhanta will be then told by the Shrota actually. So the Ajatashatru, whatever he says, will be the Siddhanta, and this Gargyaha Balakihi, whatever he says, is the Purvapaksha. So his view is the, in English they call it prima facie view and all that, if you read some books. So Purvapaksha is called prima facie view, and Siddhanta I think is called the whatever ascertained view or whatever, I don't know, they use some other term I think, whatever is established as the final view. Okay, so here this whole thing is presented in the form of a story having a Purvapaksha and Siddhanta. That is the idea. And if you do like that, Bhashyakara says, Shrotuhu Chittasya Vashameti. He says it will easily reach the minds of the people. It is easily graspable. Okay, if you don't do like this, what will happen? Now he gives other scene. What is that? Viparyayehi. So if otherwise what? Okay, if you do it differently or the opposite manner, what is that? Tarka Shastravate. केवलार्थ अनुगम वाक्यैः समर्प्यमानः दुर्विज्ञेयः स्यात् अत्यंत सूक्ष्मत्वात् वस्तुनः. सो अदरवाइज इफ यू डू इट द ऑपोजिट वे मींस व्हाट लाइक प्रेजेंटिंग इन द तर्कशास्त्र और नोवडेज यू कैन टेक लीगलीज करेक्ट यू कैन से समथिंग सिंपली और यू कैन राइट इट लाइक अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट यू गिव टू अ लॉयर दे राइट इट इन अ मैनर दैट यू वोंट इवन अंडरस्टैंड what they are saying, but they will say that this is the most precise way to draft it, correct? So you have to actually get another Bhashya, Tika and all that to understand what they have written in that. Or we also, every day we go to some website, we open some software and they say that read this agreement and agree, correct? All of us agree without reading it. Because even if you read, I don't know whether you are going to understand anything. So that is like the Tarka Shastra. In fact, Tarka Shastra also I studied. Pujya Swamiji told me don't study actually. But I myself and Kalyan, my friend, we both went and studied Tarka also. But then we gave it up after some time. We understood that this is not for us. Because they built a huge palace, you can say, without any foundation to start with. Okay. And for that they use a very let us say the kind of language they use. So they think that they are defining more and more precisely, correct? For that purpose, they keep on, even a simple thing, they will say it in such a manner that your head will spin at the end of the day. So it doesn't really give you any clarity, really speaking. But anyway, some people like that, and some people say that you should not study Vedanta without studying Nyaya, correct? Even Pujya Swamiji used to say that in Rishikesh itself, they will say that if you study Vedanta without studying Nyaya, they call it Anyaya Vedanta. Okay. But anyway, so here Bhashyakara says, if like in Tarka Shastra, kevala artha anugama vakyehi. So you only straight away only talk about the subject matter, let us say, in a dry manner. Then what it is difficult to understand. Vakyaihi samarpyamanaha durvijñeyaha syat, he says. It is not easy to understand. It is difficult to understand if it is presented in a manner like in the Tarka Shastra. Why? Because further, this Brahman itself is very subtle. Atyanta sukshmatvat vastunaha. Also, whatever subject matter which is being presented itself is very subtle. Again, because here we have to teach you something which you cannot objectify, which cannot be indicated by any words, which cannot be objectified by the mind. Still, we have to teach you that through words only. So it is something subtle. But at the same time, it is also the only thing which can be taught completely. That is the beauty here. Because Brahman alone can be completely taught because it is partless. all other things, whatever you know, it can be further divided into something else. It can be further reduced into something else, correct? You say, I know pot. Then I ask you, do you know what is clay? You say, okay, I know clay. Then what about silica molecules? Maybe you don't know what is silica molecule. Then somebody says, no, I know enough chemistry. Then what about all the atoms? What about quarks, particles? Means then you don't know any quantum physics. Like this, it can keep on going. Even then, they have not reached any end there. Okay, they don't know. So many things are still a puzzle. So this kind of knowledge, knowledge of the objective world, can never come to an end, because it keeps on, you can keep on reducing something to something else, because it's all parts. But Brahman is the partless whole. It is yourself, in fact. It is the only thing which can be taught completely without leaving out anything. That being one side, even then it is a very subtle thing. It's not very easy to teach and even understand. Even if you understand, you are not able to retain it or assimilate it completely. Even if you retain it and assimilate it, many times it is not available when it should be available. So all these problems are there. These things have to be overcome. So that's okay. For that, we have to, there is a well laid out way of doing all these things. You have to keep doing it. Don't ask how many days and all that. That cannot be said. Until you don't ask any questions, you have to keep doing, I think. That's all. Okay, so in this context, now Bhashyakara is trying to establish how this Brahman is very sukshma, very subtle. So he now quotes Kathopanishad. He says, Tatha cha katake shravanayapi bahubiryaha na labhyaha. So Yama is saying this. He says, Nachiketa asks him about Brahman, correct? Then Yama does not want to teach him really. He says, I will give you all this, some chariots, dancing girls. Why don't you enjoy all that? And then Nachiketa finally says, Tavaiva vahaha tava nritya gite. Like that he says, you keep all these things yourself and teach me whatever I want. Then later on Yama says this. He says, this Atma Vastu is difficult to know. And even if I teach, correct, even those who listen to it, then also they do not get it. They don't understand or they don't assimilate. So it is a difficult thing that way. Many people, even if they listen to this teaching, it doesn't reach them. They do not get it. So shravanayapi bahubirna labhyaha. So the same thing is said in Gita also. Ascharyavat pasyati kaschidenam, ascharyavat vadati tathaiva chanyaha. Ascharyavat chainam anya shrinoti, shrutvapyenam veda nachaiva kaschit. So Bhagavan says, even the one who says this itself is a very wonderful thing. The Vedanta, one who teaches this, that Vedanta can be taught itself is a wonder. And listening to that also is wonderful. But more than that, what, even if you listen, many people do not understand, do not get it. So that is there. And then further what? Ityadi vakyaihi samskrita deva buddhi gamyatvam samanya matra buddhi agamyatvam cha saprapancham darshitam. So like this, many places, different Upanishad, Bhagavad Gita, everywhere it has been said that, like drishyate tu agreya buddhya, like that also it is there, vakya, correct? This is seen only by a sharp intellect. Drishyate tu agreya buddhya sukshmaya sukshma darshibihi also is there. Although Bhashyakara is not quoting it here, that also is in Kathopanishad, I think. So, like this, there are n number of vakyas are there, which is all telling you what, to understand this Brahman, you should have a Samskrita Deva Buddhi, Bhashyakara says. So you have to have a Pakva has to be there, correct? You have to have matured, well matured. Samskrita here means well matured, maturity in terms of emotional maturity, intellectual maturity, both are important. So Sanskrita Deva Buddhi Gamyatvam is there for this Brahman. Means the Brahman can only be known through a well-matured emotional and intellectual person. Okay. Not by normal people. Samanya Matra Buddhi Agamyatvam. Also, another thing here is that this Deva Asura was talked about even in the third Brahmana of the first chapter here. So what do we say, or who is Deva? Because why Bhashyakara has to use the Deva Shabda here, I was thinking. In English, you can simply translate it as divine intellect. But I don't think it is conveying much. Correct? Simply saying divine intellect means then no human being can learn them. It will become like that. But I think what the meaning should be here is that Deva Asura was talked about in the third Brahmana of the first chapter. So there, what does Bhashyakara say? Deva means whenever you lead your life as per the Shastra, then you are Deva. Who is Asura? Asura means you go by your own likes and dislikes or whatever your according to your prakriti, because the nature of each and every indriya is to go after the indriya vishaya, correct? All senses and mind also goes along with the senses, and they are all going after sense objects. That is how normal people are living, and that's what we say asusu ramate iti asuraha. But then that asura only becomes deva. See, in that third Brahmana, interesting story is what? There are indriyas are there. Indriyas, when they do something for their own sake, they become asura. But when they do it for a common good, okay, then, and also they do it as per whatever the Shastra says, means you become Deva, like this Bhashyakara says that. So here Sanskrita Deva Buddhi means we have to say that the Buddhi which goes or which is in tune with Shastra, right? Whatever the Shastra is revealing, if you are able to go along with that, then only you can, because Shastra alone is Pramana again for knowing this Brahman. All other Laukika Pramanas, everybody has. Samanya people also have, correct? Normal people, they also have sense perception, inference. They may have all these pramanas, and the way they use it may be different, but they all have. Everybody has, samanya people have this worldly means of knowledge, we can say, laukika pramana. But only if you come to the Vaidika pramana, only if you accept the Veda as a pramana, and you are ready to go along with the Shastra and have Shraddha in the Shastra, then only you can get this Brahman. So otherwise, Brahman is agamyam only. It is not, it cannot be gained. It cannot be known. So that has been shown very clearly. Saprapancham darshitam. Okay, it has been shown in different Upanishads. And further he quotes for that. Acharyavan purusho veda. Again, so again, nowadays the trend is what? Do not learn from any guru. You don't require any guru. Or have Dattatreya, they'll give an example. He learned from 24 gurus. Everything is a guru in the world. All that is fine. If you already know something, each and everything can teach you something based on that, maybe for assimilating. But straight away, these things cannot become guru, correct? First, you should go to a guru, you study the Shastra, you understand what the Shastra is telling. At least first you should do Shravanam and then understand what the Shastra is telling about you. Now, afterwards, everything can be a guru for assimilating the teaching, if you have the right attitude again. But without going to any guru, without studying Shastra, you cannot sit somewhere and then say that I have learned from a bee. And all this, correct? In that story, then Dattatreya is supposed to learn from so many different things. There is a huge list is there. But that will not work, because even the Upanishad itself says here, Acharyavan Purusho Veda, the one who has Acharya, there's a story also in this, that one person, this Chandogya story is there. He is picked up by some robbers, his eyes are tied, and he is left behind in a forest. And then some person who is walking that side comes and unties this person, but this person has no idea. He is totally like clueless about which direction he has to go. And then he has to ask that other person, and then one by one he has to keep asking, correct? And then he reaches. Like that, there is a story and all is told there. Only to say that you require the help of an acharya. Acharya only has to teach you the shastra. Why should I not read myself? This is another problem. Everybody has a problem to go and read from somebody else. But like Pujya Swamiji used to say, even to interpret one vakya of the shastra, you should know the entire shastra. Then it becomes a catch-22, correct? If you are reading it yourself, how are you going to understand unless you have the understanding of the totality about the full vision? Then only you can correctly interpret. Any sentence can be interpreted in any manner. And Sanskrit grammar being so flexible, you can also, even atma atatva masi, you can say, correct? Simple. The one who has learnt a little bit of sandhi, he can say that atma tattva masi is there. Why cannot I take it as atma atatva masi? Valid. Grammatically valid. But then can we fit it into that context or not? So who is going to teach you all that? Means you have to have a guru. The one who knows the entire shastra alone can interpret even one sentence of the shastra properly and teach you. So acharya van purusho veda. So you have to go and learn from an acharya. Acharya dhyaiva vidya. So vidya also only from acharya. Acharya ki eva. Okay. Vidya. Vidya is only from acharya. Like this in Chandogya it is said. Okay. Then Gita also. What upadekshyanti te jnanam jnaninas tattva darshinah. So jnanis, tattva darshis, they will tell you. In fact, the first part of this is what? Tadviddhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya. Upadekshyanti te jnanam jnaninas tattva darshinah. That is the verse here. So you go and learn this tadviddhi, this Brahman, you learn. How do you go and approach the guru? So tadviddhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya. So you go with the right attitude. You don't go with an attitude to prove your guru wrong. Guru does not require anything from you really. So you go with an attitude to learn means you have to go with a certain correct attitude to learn. It's not to prove anybody right or wrong. You want to understand what is the truth about yourself. So it has to be a very personal pursuit that way. And it has to make sense to you personally. And it has to solve your fundamental problem also. All that has to happen. And it has to transform you. That means you have to approach this whole thing as a burning problem which you are having, correct? So once you sense that it is a problem, it is your own problem you are trying to solve, your attitude will be automatically proper. You are not going for time pass or trolling somebody and all that. Okay, so you go with the right attitude means pranipatena, that means you salute your guru, you do namaskara. You have the right attitude. You don't say that the guru is wrong. So at least initially you have to say that I have to improve my understanding. That much we have to have the attitude. So not only that, pariprashnena, okay, you can ask questions. Questioning is not a problem. Entire Bhagavad Gita also is because Arjuna kept on asking questions. Till the 18th chapter, he did not leave. In fact, sometimes I feel he is asking the same thing again and again. But Bhagavan also answers patiently. Again and again, he is answering the same thing in different language. So you read second chapter, the entire subject matter is over, really speaking. But then he asks some questions. Because he was thinking that he has to do something. Okay. but Bhagavan looks like Bhagavan is saying something else. So he could not reconcile that. So he kept on asking questions. So you can ask questions, but we say that is what Sambhada, but the questioning again has to be done in a manner where you try to understand the truth. Not for, there are many types of debates and all that are there, correct? We talk about all that. Vada, Jalpa, Vitanda and all. So we are not going into all that. The student-teacher conversation is called Samvada because here the goal is not to prove the other wrong or anything. Only to understand what is the teaching and how does it really help you. Okay. So we have to approach that way. And then question. Pariprashnena sevaya. Also, you should be ready to do any seva to your guru. So Bhagavan is saying that. So in those days, seva means what? You have to take all the cows in the morning and be with the cows, graze the cows, come back in the evening maybe. Then if the guru thinks that, okay, I'll teach you for half an hour or something maybe. So they, even like Indra and all, the story is there, correct? Indra, they did Gurukulavasa for many, many years, in fact. 32 years like that, if you see that story. And then finally, in fact, Prajapati told only one word. After 32 years of seva, the Prajapati taught very little. Then another 32 years went. But okay, in reality, we are not going to do like that here. Even if you come to our Gurukulam here, I can send you with our cows if you want to, that is. But really, we are not asking you to do all that. But at least we should have that attitude to do seva. Then what upadekshyanti te jnaninaha upadekshyanti, they will give upadesha, they will teach you. And what kind of jnanis means what? Tattva darshinaha, the ones who are seeing the truth, who have the vision, who have the right vision of themselves, who know the truth, then they can communicate it to you. Now here also, I think Madhvacharya actually uses grammar here. He says, Upadekshanti te ajnanam. The Pujya Swamiji used to say this, in fact, I remember. So, Upadekshanti te, here as per Sanskrit grammar, you can put ajnanam also. Then ajnanam, why should anybody teach ajnanam? The one who is already a tattvadarshi, why should that person teach ajnanam? I really don't know. In fact, I have not read the Bhagavad Gita Bhashya of Madhva. But I think Pujya Swamiji used to say that. He used to say that some Acharya actually takes it as Upadekshanti te ajnanam, like that. But I don't think that's correct reading. Anyway, so iti cha Gita. So in the Gita, it has been said like this. So therefore, you have to go and learn from somebody. That is the idea here. You cannot do self-study. You have to learn it from the Shastra. And you have to go and learn the Shastra also from a guru. So ihapi cha shakalya yagnyavalkya samvadena ati gahvaratvam mahata samrambhena brahmanaha vakshyati. So even in this Upanishad, later on we will see there is a samvada between shakalya and yagnyavalkya. So in that again Brahman is revealed, but as very ati gahvaratvam means what? It is very very subtle, we can say. Very difficult, something as something which is very gambhira, ati gambhira, we have to say. Means very deep. So it's not very easy to understand. And mahata samrambhena, samrambha here means tikakara only is coming to my help, because otherwise if you see the meaning for samrambha, it doesn't fit in here. Anandagiri says samrambha means here tatparya. So we have to say otherwise it is shown in a very great detailed manner that how difficult it is to learn this Brahma Vidya. That is being again, that will be talked about, that will be shown in the conversation between Yajnavalkya and Shakalya later. Therefore, what tasmat slishtaha eva akhyayika rupena purvapaksha siddhanta rupam apadya vastu samarpanartaha arambaha. So this start to this new Brahmana, slishtaha means what? It is fit, it is proper. Therefore, it is proper. What is proper? That this Brahmana is starting with a story, akhyayika rupena, in the form of a story, and again in that story also it is presenting to you a Purvapaksha and Siddhanta. So by presenting a Purvapaksha and Siddhanta, the vastu is being taught, and by telling it in the form of a story, it is made easier for you to grasp. So that is the idea. And also further, what this is one point he has established, then he gives another meaning, another thing also. Why it is being said as a story means, in the story we can also teach some other things, correct? So he says achara vidhi upadeshartascha. That means what? How do you approach a teacher, or how does a brahmana approach a king, or how does a king talk to a brahmana? All these things are there, correct? The achara, the conduct. Okay, what are the rules of conduct? Those things are also revealed here by telling it as a story, because this person is vakta. Vakta is a brahmana here, even though he does not know, but you will see how the king actually addresses the brahmana. And Shrota is the king, and he knows the vastu, but still the way he conducts himself, all these things are again they are some kind of teachings only for us. We have to look into those things and also understand. So achara vidhi upadeshartascha, so for the purpose of revealing all these rules of conduct, you can say. So evam acharavatoho vaktrushrotroho akyayika anugataha arthaha avagamyate. So that's what. So in this manner, see here, both the shrota and vakta are acharavataha, means what? They know their rules of conduct. So even though the vakta is initially is presented as a proud of balaki, means he is a very proud fellow, okay, even though he is an ajnani, or only because of ajnana I think he is proud or arrogant, you can say, but still he has a certain, the way he conducts himself, all that is important. And king also knows, but still the way he conducts himself, those things are very interesting. So from that, from all these things in the story alone, we can gain certain things, we can understand certain things. So that is also the reason why it is presented as a story. Further, what? Kevala tarka buddhi nishedarthaha cha akhyayika. Okay, another thing is what? This akhyayika also is teaching you that tarka alone is not good enough. Tarkasya pratishthana, like that there is a sutra is there. Naisha, that is there. Bhashyakara only quotes here. Naisha tarkena matirapaneya katopanishad. Do not let your mind be taken away by tarka. Even Pujya Swamiji also was very guarded. That's why his own students, he did not want to get too much into tarka, or even Vyakarana for that matter. Because many people teach Vedanta class as Sanskrit, but I never understood that part of that. Maybe in a Sanskrit class, you can take a Vedanta text and teach it as Sanskrit, but you should not teach a Vedanta class as a Sanskrit, I think. Anyway, so if it goes like that, then you are more interested only in which Paniniya Sutra to use to arrive at this particular form and all that. You will be spending your attention on that. So that is not what we want. And that means in Vedanta, Shraddha is important, correct? Shraddha means you have to know, look upon the Veda as a means of knowledge, as a Pramana. Whatever the Veda, the Guru says is the Pramana. And in each and every class, you have to look at yourself in the light of whatever is the teaching. So every class itself is a sadhana only. In fact, there is no better sadhana than repeated shravanam. This is what Sureshwara says. So even there is no separate need of any manana, nididhyasana and all that. All of them are nothing but if you keep on doing repeated shravanam, that itself is equivalent to manana, nididhyasana. Everything is taken care of in that. So that shraddha is important. And each and every class is nothing but pramana vyapara. So you have to let the pramana operate. And what is the hindrance for the pramana to operate? Your own will only, your own likes and dislikes, your own preconditions. So maybe everybody has to take some effort with reference to all these things, so that we are free enough to receive and let the pramana take over, let it operate. So kevala tarka buddhi nishedartha, so it is negating that you should not approach the study of Vedanta only with logic. Shruti sammata tarka is still fine, but many people nowadays, it's the biggest problem, correct? Everything is a science for everybody. Inner engineering, bliss technology, all these things I see. So they are abusing terminologies and unnecessarily confusing also. Veda becomes science. Everything is science. Religion is science. Then why should then everybody should become scientist? I think nobody need to go anywhere else. So that is all. I think some confusion is there. People are confused between what is valid and what is scientific. So they are, I think they are using these words interchangeably. By saying that something is scientific, all they want to say is it is valid knowledge. But the point is that everything scientific is not valid, and everything valid need not be scientific also. So this is a very simple thing. People fail to understand that. So anyway, here Upanishad itself says naisha tarkena matirapaneya. So don't let your mind be taken away by this tarka. And also he is quoting Mahabharata here, na tarka shastra dagdhaya. So the one who is burnt by tarka shastra, it seems, tarka shastra dagdhaya na. So this vidya is not for the one who is only using tarka. Iti shruti smriti bhyam, like this it is said here. So shraddha cha brahma vijnane paramam sadanam, that's what. So not just tarka, but shraddha is the most important thing. It is a paramam sadanam, Bhashyakara says. It is the most important means or sadhana for gaining brahma vijnana is what? To have the pramana buddhi and shraddha in the shastra and guru. Iti akhyayikarthah, that is also the meaning of this story. Tata hi gargya jata, okay, shatro, okay, gargya jatra shatroho ativa shraddaluta, okay. See this gargya jata, okay, gargya ajata shatroho, sorry, I did not break it properly and got confused. Sometimes this is a problem with all this sandhi. Okay, gargya is our guy, the vakta, okay, the brahmana, ajata shatru. So gargya ajata shatroho ativa shraddaluta drishyate. So there shraddha is also shown in this story. We'll see that as we go forward. So akhyayikayam drishyate ativa shraddaluta of this gargya and ajata shatru. There shraddha, how much shraddalu they are, the ones with shraddha, that also is being shown through this story. And Bhagavan also says shraddhavan labhate jnanam, correct? So only the one who has shraddha gains this knowledge. Shraddhavan, but not only shraddhavan is alone is not enough. Even there Bhagavan says shraddhavan labhate jnanam tatpara sanyatendriyaha, okay, you have to be tatparaha and also sanyatendriyaha also, correct? Then you can jnanam labdva param shantim, okay, then you get param shantim and all that. But you have to first be, you have to be tatparaha, means what? You have to be a mumukshuhu. You have to be a mumukshu and then approach the shastra as a jignas. Otherwise you can study the shastra even as a scholar, you can get PhD, but it's not going to change you one bit. So it is very important how we approach the shastra. We approach the shastra because I recognize that I have a problem and I want to solve it. That is the only way you can approach the shastra, I think. That is the only meaningful way to approach it. All other ways are really useless. So tatparaha sanyatendriya, then what? Even then you have to have certain vairagya. You have to have your indriyas under your vasha, correct? That means you have to now do things as per the whatever the shastra says, not like your natural tendency is something else, but you should be able to now overcome that natural tendency and do things as per whatever shastra is saying. Then, and also being a shraddhavan, you gain this jnanam. Shraddhavan labhate jnanam only, we quote normally, but in the same vakya two other things are also there which are also equally important, in fact. So like this smriti also is there. So now Bhashyakara has given a beautiful introduction. Now let us go and actually see what is this story. Om dripta balakihi ha anuchanah gargyah asa sahovacha ajata shatrum kashyam brahmate bravaniti. So this dripta balakihi, this person is called dripta balakihi. Driptaha means again somebody who is proud or arrogant. So this dripta balaki is there and he goes to this king, okay, proud balaki, and he is a vakta. So vakta means here what you can say, a lecturer. See, he is not, he is one being a brahmana, he has done veda adhyayanam, but not only he has done veda adhyayanam, but he is also a teacher. We have to understand, he is, so he has enough confidence in the subject matter to teach. That's why he is a vakta. Vakta means you can take nowadays lecturer and all, we say, correct? In the college also we have lecturers. So this person is the anuchanaha, that is, okay, anuchanaha means the one he can give lectures. And this person, he went and said to Ajatashatru. Ajatashatru is the listener here, and he is Kashyam. Kashyam means Kashi Raja. So he is the Raja in Kashi. And what did he say? He says, Brahmate Bravaniti. So I will now tell you about Brahman. I will talk to you about Brahman. He says that. Then Ajatashatru, then what does he say? Right now we don't know anything about Ajatashatru. But here Ajatashatru immediately, what does he say? He says, Sahasram. Okay, Braviniti. Then he says, Saho vacha Ajatashatruhu. Sahasram etasyam vachi dadmaha janakaha janakaha iti vai janaha dhavanti iti. Okay, so he says, just for, see, he has not even told about Brahman, correct? Even just saying that I will talk to you about Brahman, the king became so happy. He said, I will give you 1,000 cows, okay, for that. Just for coming and telling that I am going to now talk to you about Brahman. That's all he says. For that, the king is giving 1,000 cows. I don't know what he will do with 1,000 cows. Even with 35 cows, we are having problems now. But in those days, it was not a problem. Wealth was only measured in terms of cows, correct? Even in Tamil, we say anirai and all that. And a means wealth. Even in Tamil, it means wealth and it means cows also. So cows were looked upon as wealth, really. So the king gave this brahmana 1,000 cows, just because he came and told that I am going to talk to you about Brahman. Okay. Then further he says something which is very interesting. Okay. He says, Yetasyam vachi datmaha janakaha janakaha iti vai jana dhavanti, he says. So for this, whatever speech you gave or whatever you said, for that only I'll give you 1,000 cows. And further he says, everybody is running, it seems. People are running saying Janaka, Janaka. That means Janaka also gives 1,000 cows. That we will see later. In fact, he gives so many cows to Yajnavalkya. And that story also is very interesting. There are 1,000 cows, and not only just cows, he has also tied on the horns of the cows gold coins. So then there is a, in the Janaka's court, there is a debate going on, and whoever is the winner can take all the cows along with the gold coins. Then Yajnavalkya enters there and tells his Shishya that you first take away all the cows. Okay, that is his confidence. He knows that he will win. So even before the debate starts, he asks his Shishya to actually take away the cows and all that. So Janaka is very famous for giving all this to Brahmanas. So they are all these people are anyway running, saying that Janaka, Janaka. So he, Ajatashatru here says, I am like that. Okay. Not only Janaka is the one who gives all these things, but I am also like that. I am also going to give you 1,000 cows because you told me that you are going to tell me about Brahman. Okay. So then what Bhashyakara says, Tatra Purvapakshavadi Avidya Vishaya Brahmavite Dripta Balakihi. So this Dripta Balaki is the Purvapakshavadi. He is the Purvapakshin who is presenting Brahman from the standpoint of a Avidyavan, Ajnani. So Avidya Vishaya Brahmavite means what? Brahman from the standpoint of Avidya. How normal ignorant people look at Brahman. That alone he knows. So he is the Purvapakshavadi, but still he is proud. Dripta Balakihi. So Driptaha means Garvitaha, Bhashyakara says. So Driptaha means Garvitaha. He has Garva, he has pride, arrogance. And what Asamyak Brahma Vitva Deva. And why he is proud means he doesn't understand Brahman properly. Because if you are a properly knowledgeable person with wisdom, so Bhagavan also what he says, Vidya Vinaya Sampanne. So Vidya Vinaya Sampannaha, like that only this jnanis are talked about. So Vidya means Vinaya also has to be there. Some humility has to be there. But he did not have any of that because he did not understand Brahman properly. Samyak Brahma Vidva Deva. Samyak Jnanam is not there. Clear knowledge, proper knowledge is not there. His knowledge of Brahman was not proper. Because of that only he is arrogant, it seems, or proud. Also, Balakihi means what? That is also another Taddita. He says, Balakayaha Apatyam Balakihi. So that is the Vyutpatti he is giving. Balaka, the son of Balaka. Balakayaha Apatyam Balakihi. Driptascha Asau Balakischa Iti Dripta Balakihi. So again, the Samasa Vigraha he is giving. The compound, how it has come. So this is Karmadarya. He says, Driptascha Asau Balakischa. That's how the Dripta Balakihi, this word has come. Ha Shabdaha Aitihyartaha Akhyayikayam. Also there is a Ha is there. Dripta Balakihi Ha Anuchanaha. Why this Ha is there means to show that this is a well-known story or whatever. In the story, we are just pointing out certain things, correct? And these things are all known to us from a long time back. So the particle Ha means it is something traditionally known, you can say. Okay, it indicates that. Aitihyartham means what? This is how it was, like that. That is the tradition. So the tradition itself is indicated by the Ha particle, that Shabda. Anuchanaha means Anuvachana Samarthaha Vakta Vagmi. So the one who is capable of retort. You can say Anuvachana means talking after, or really here you can say just lecturing. One who is capable of lecturing, he is a Vakta or Vagmi. He can talk. He not only knows, but he can also teach, we can say. And Gargyaha, Gotrataha. So Gargyaha means Garga Gotra. So the Anpratyaya can come even in the meaning of Gotra. It can come in the meaning of Apatyam also. Tasya Apatyam is one Panini Sutra. Then it can come in the meaning of many different meanings. One of the meanings is Gotra. So here, Garga Gotrayaha Jataha. So one who is born in the Garga Gotra, that person is Gargyaha. Asa Babhuva, so he was there. Kvachit Kala Visheshe means Asa means sometime in the past. We don't know when. OK. Okay. And then he says, Sahovacha Ajatashatrum Ajatashatru Namanam Kashyam Kashi Rajam Abhigamya. So going to this Kashi Raja, okay, who is Ajatashatru, who has the name of Ajatashatru, he told him, what? Brahmate Bravaniti, I will now talk to you about Brahma. Brahmate Tubhyam Bravani Kathayani. So I will talk to you about Brahman. So in this way, when told by this Brahmana, then Ajatashatru, what did he say? Sahasram Gavam Dadmaha Yetasyam Vachi. So for these words, whatever you told me, I'll give you 1,000 cows. Okay. So that is very nice. Yama Pratyavochaha Brahmate Bravaniti. तावन मात्रमेव गोसहस्र प्रदाने निमित्तम इत्यभिप्रायः. ओके, सी व्हाट एवर यू टोल्ड टुवर्ड्स मी, करेक्ट. यामा प्रत्यवोचः ब्रह्म. सो यू टोल्ड दैट यू विल टॉक टू मी अबाउट ब्रह्मन, करेक्ट. ब्रह्मते ब्रवाणीति, फॉर दैट अलोन. तावन मात्रमेव, सो भाष्यकार मेक्स इट क्लियर हियर, इट इज नॉट फॉर दैट लाइक ही taught this Raja about Brahman and that's why he got this 1,000 cows. No, it is just that he said that I will teach you or I will talk to you about Brahman. For that alone, this 1,000 cows have been given. That is the Abhipraya here. So, Sakshat Brahma Katanam Eva Nimittam Asman Na Upekshyate Sahasra Dane Brahmate Bravaniti Yamevatu Vak Nimittam apekshyate iti uchyate. Okay, all these things we'll see. I think we are time up. We'll see next week. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om.
Dhanyavaad.
धन्यवाद गुरुजी.